should have. That would have been a good thought about 10 minutes ago, I think. Well, good morning. It's good to see everybody here. Why don't you guys stand? We'll wake ourselves up a tad this morning.
Only a God like you, only a God.
sing with me, girls, sing with them.
Holy girls, you are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are mighty.
Worthy of praise.
That song itself said more words than you've said and probably since 8:30 this morning, right? Oh, man, yeah. Well, we're awake now. Praise the Lord. All right. Well, it's good to see you guys here today. It's good to be in God's presence with you. And we are asking the Holy Spirit to just do His thing today. So excited to have Morgan and Bethany with their spouses here, Tanner and Isaac. The Purpich family is in the house. We miss Eric. We want to say hi to Eric, too. And so, yes, we glad to have, I know Mama's glad to have them all around. So it's always good. And
Baby Rafe on the way.
Baby Rafe is on the way. That's right. So, yes, very excited about that. We've grown up with them. And so it's so cool to see them start a family and start their lives together. And man, you know, that's the cool stuff, right? Mm-hmm. Being a part of each other's lives in a way that we can celebrate these milestones and see God moving in their lives. And so it's a very cool thing. Well, it is great to be in God's presence with you. It's great to be here today. And I just hope that you jump in and let the Lord speak to you today. He has drawn you here today. He has a word for you today. And so we want to know for each of us what that is today. So, yes, amen and amen.
Who could imagine the melody?
There is
Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Yeah. thoughts define me. You're inside me. You're my reality.
Sing it to him, yes.
Abba, I belong to you. Abba, I belong to you. You're closer than the skin on my
means Daddy God. Let's sing and serve today like you know him. All right, ready?
Bye.
Dear Lord, it is our heart's cry that we could just simply come before you and say, Abba, Abba, Father. That the closeness and the intimacy there is more than just words on a page or a song that we sing. It is crying out, Abba, Daddy, because we have relationship with you. Abba, Father.
Yes.
Abba, Father. We love you. We thank you, Lord, for that closeness. We thank you that you desire relationship with each and every one of us today. And we just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you for being our Abba, Father. Thank you for being our Abba, Father. Thank you for being our Abba, Father. We love you. We praise you. There's not enough in a song or a melody, Lord, that would capture, Lord, what you have done for us. And may our heart overflow at wanting to express that. Oh God, we need you and we need more of you.
Yeah.
And to have more of us, you need more of us. For us to lay down who we are, lay down our expectations of who we think we are, maybe who others are. So that we can just come before you, palms open, saying, here I am, Lord. I am yours, and you are my Abba, Father. We love you and we praise you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated if you can. We've got sound, yeah? Okay. If you are a kiddo and you want to be a part of our children's group, follow out those two doors with our crew. They will have a great time out there in the children's building. And I assure you of that. They all do such a great job back there with them. And allow us time together in the Lord's presence here. Hearing it in our way, and they get it in their way, right? Well, it's great to see everybody. It is great to be here. It's always refreshing to get in God's presence and hear His voice. And so, yes, glad for that today. All right, so you know I love to start with a quick funny. So this is from our the last time I read from a satire website called The Babylon Bee, and I found another one that I just could not pass up. All right, so this one is for all you coffee drinkers out there. This will minister to you something fierce. All right, here we go. So the headline reads: Study finds most sin a direct result of not having enough coffee in your system, all right? Somebody shout amen on that, yeah. All right, so this is the study. And I think I do have an image. Yeah, they've provided us a graph here. Okay, yeah. All right, so a new study has, this is all satire, okay? Let's be clear. All right, a new study has shown what coffee drinkers have known for a long time to be true. A lack of coffee directly increases the sinfulness of your thoughts, attitudes, emotions, and desires. For instance,
you're much more likely to want to punch somebody in the face before you've had that sweet, sweet nectar from heaven, said researcher Dr. Bob Anthony Anderson. As you consume more and more coffee, the chances that you'll give somebody the bird, snap at your kids, and tell somebody you wish they were dead decreases dramatically, okay? According to researchers, once you've had about 2 gallons of coffee for the day, you approach near perfect levels of sanctification, nearing the righteousness of Tim Tebow, Kirk Cameron, and Billy Graham, all right? Before you start drinking coffee, you're pretty much Satan incarnate, right? Well, and again, Mr. Anderson says, well, I don't want to jump to too many conclusions, but the research seems clear here. You should drink as much coffee as possible if you desire to truly be Christ-like. It's a difficult sacrifice, but if we're serious about our Christian walk, it seems we should apply the results of this study to our lives and go suck down some more delicious pour-overs, cappuccinos, and iced lattes. So there you go. There's your public service announcement for the day. Yeah. Yes, they are, the articles they brought, I know the fact that they carry out, it's one thing to see a headline, but they actually carry this article all the way out. It's just so funny to me. All right, so enough of nonsense. All right, and just to be clear, yeah, coffee has nothing to do with your spiritual walk, all right? Just so we are on the same page, all right? Some may still differ after that, yeah. I do want to let you know, on October the 20th, we will be having our first vision dinner for New Day Fellowship. And we're gonna provide a time. We're gonna cater the food. We want everybody to be apart when nobody's left having to clean up stuff. We just want to be able to come together, eat together, and be able to understand what's New Day look like moving forward. And so we'll talk everything from church structure to vision, mission, and how it will involve each and every one of us here at New Day. So October 20th. So put that on your calendar and you will continue to see announcements on that. So, all right. Well, from time to time, after people meet my kids, I'm going to kind of brag on my kids a little bit today. After they meet our kids for the first time, or after they've watched them for a bit, I'll have people come up and tell me, man, you guys are so blessed. And I totally agree with that statement, absolutely, unequivocally, and wholeheartedly. But their next question usually is, man, what did you guys do? And, now mind you, my kids are not perfect, all right? This just in, all right? Nor are we as parents perfect at all. Lots of grace, lots of prayer. But there were some definite, tangible things that the Holy Spirit prompted us to do along the way in raising our kids. A couple of things. We did not and have not allowed them to fight with one another. Doesn't mean they don't get into arguments, but we stamped that out pretty quickly. That's just not an option in our house. So we resolve the disagreement, whether it's just a disagreement over who's getting to do the dishes or it's a personality difference, which can be quite comical because sometimes in my younger two, I almost have heard verbatim arguments that my wife and I have had, at different times. It's very funny. If nobody realizes it, Dax is my mini-me and Bailey is Danielle's. Yes, so it's quite humorous at times. So, but instead of addressing behaviors, which is well past what, the checkpoint, we actually have addressed mindsets. So, and this is totally a Holy Spirit thing, because when we hear different things in come out of their mouth, whether it was Alyssa to Bailey, if it was a mindset that they were taking on that was not necessarily one that was rooted in the truth of God, we would address that in some way. And, it, you know, it wasn't just kind of a flippant, you know, sentence here or there. If we really saw them kind of say it with a different spirit, you know what I mean, where they were actually kind of owning something that they probably shouldn't have, we start addressing those mindsets and talking about those and going, why do you feel this way? Why are you thinking this way? And definitely those moments were prompted by the Holy Spirit for sure. You know, we do not want to own mindsets that are contrary to who God says we are. So these have been values that of our parenting that we have maintained. But I think that the two most important pieces that I always share with those who have asked that question of us, and again, we are not perfect parents in this, but I can absolutely, unequivocally tell you the key to having a great relationship with your kids and a great walk in the journey with them is if you teach them to love Jesus and to hear the Holy Spirit, it solves so many problems. Love Jesus and hear the Holy Spirit. And we haven't done that right all the time. But I can tell you God's grace has been in it as we have pursued teaching them to love Jesus. They obviously love worship. They love to worship Jesus. They love Jesus. And that part, it was first and foremost. And then it's how to hear the Holy Spirit. Even as young as Dax and Bailey are, they are beginning to recognize how the Holy Spirit speaks to them. And that's a treasure. That is an absolute treasure. So we tried to model and teach them how to love Jesus. And it does start with modeling. You have to model that in your home. And second of all, teaching them how to hear the Holy Spirit's voice. So if we can teach ourselves and our children these two lessons, then many of the issues that we are faced with today as parents and certainly as people will actually be addressed and we will be equipped to deal with some of the cultural issues that are on the outside. So over the course of the last couple of months, we have talked about the basics of our faith, and basics being loving the Lord with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, right? Well, today we're going to actually talk about how do we actually hear the Holy Spirit's voice. You know, in knowing someone, you generally need to have some commonalities, right? Even if it's nothing more than being able to talk to them or being in the general proximity with them, right? It's hard to have a relationship with somebody if you don't spend any time together, right? If you're not anywhere close, if you're not talking and around them, you generally are not going to know that person. So to say that we know someone is generally a deeper insinuation that means that we've spent time with them, we understand who they are, and you can generally predict their response to certain situations based off the knowledge of seeing that person respond in those different situations. Does that make sense? Even though you might not have seen them to respond to a certain scenario, because you've seen a pattern of their lifestyle, then you generally can kind of feel like, okay, I kind of know them. It feels like they would do this and such. Now, obviously there's exceptions to that rule. And we've obviously experienced some of that. Some of the most, you know, what seems so contrary to character of people still do stuff that are outside of that. And that's flawed humanity for sure. But for today, understanding this character, understanding what it means to know somebody, we're gonna dive deeper into this. So certainly when it comes to knowing God. So knowing God and his character is very similar. We must spend time with him. We got to be in his word to understand his character. and how he responds to different situations biblically. You know, and then apply these different scenarios or different character traits to the different situations of life that we come against. Jesus did say that he would not leave us alone in this endeavor. He did give us his word, and he also said he has given us his Holy Spirit to guide us. Okay? So that we can actually know him, so we can know his desires for us. And he does this because he speaks to us. The Holy Spirit actually speaks to us. So I just want to let the word minister to you for a few moments. Not my words, but Jesus himself, the red letters, if you will. Right? John 14, 15 through 18 says, and we covered this in our Love the Lord series, "If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever." Who is that? The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him. For he dwells with you and will be in you. It's a promise. Jesus says, "I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you." Man, that's a hallelujah verse, if anything, right? John 10, 1 through 5. "Most assuredly," again, this is Jesus talking, "most assuredly I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber." There are a lot of people who tell you there's lots of ways to the Father. There's lots of ways to heaven. That's not what that says, right? Any other way but Jesus is coming through another door, okay, and is considered a thief and a robber. "But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the doorkeeper opens, the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. And when he brings out his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. Yet they will by no means follow a stranger, but will flee from him, for they do not know the stranger, the voice of strangers." There's a great lesson right there. We have to know the Holy Spirit's voice, right? John 10, 7 through 16, Jesus said again, "Most assuredly, I say to you," and he's reiterating again, "I am the door of the sheep. All who ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door," Jesus said. "If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal, to kill, and destroy." Jesus says, "I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly." Verse 11, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But a hireling, he who is not the shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. The hireling flees because he is a hireling and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep and am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring. And they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd." Amen. John 10, 25 through 27. Jesus again says, "I told you and you do not believe. the works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. But you do not believe because you are not of my sheep. As I said to you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. John 18:37, this will be the last one for this section here. Pilate therefore said to him, are you a king then? And Jesus answered, said, you say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. So today's sermon title is called The Voice. We need to know his voice, right? I mean, come on, that's pretty good, right? Yeah. Yes. The voice. We need to know his voice. Hey, obviously, in these scriptures, it is imperative that if you say that you are a follower of Jesus, that you hear his voice. Because even Jesus said, I don't do anything but what the Father tells me to do. So Jesus was listening to the Father and only doing those things he was supposed to do by direction of the Father. Holy Spirit is that for each of us. He gives us the Holy Spirit to be able to direct us and keep us out of those places that are not truth, where the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy, wants to isolate you, wants to make you feel like you're the only one that's ever felt this way. So why? So he can sift you and just pound you with lies to destroy you. Okay? All right. So to know God is to hear him. So how do we hear him? Holy Spirit has a voice. And if we are going to walk with the Father, we need to learn how to hear the Holy Spirit's voice. So first point is Holy Spirit has a voice. And the Holy Spirit speaks to his children. Verse 27, my sheep hear my voice, right? He has a voice and he speaks to his children, to those who have made him Lord. That's step one. If you do not know Christ as your Savior, if you've not made him the leader and Lord of your life, then you will not hear the Holy Spirit's voice. Okay? Point two is, Holy Spirit speaks and affirms the Word of God. A lot of people can say, well, the Holy Spirit says this, or the Holy Spirit says that. Well, the Holy Spirit's telling me this. But we have to have discernment. And that discernment is very important. And part of that discernment is taking what they are saying and measuring it up to the Word of God. Because Holy Spirit will never speak anything contrary to the Word of God. He just won't. Otherwise, he'd be a liar, right? He said it here and didn't say it here. Or he didn't say it here, now he's saying it here. That's not consistent. He cannot break a promise. He cannot tell a lie. That's not in his character of who he is. Verse 11 says he's a good shepherd. And he speaks life. So never condemnation. So that voice of condemnation that you hear, that's not of the Father. And if it's not of the Father, it's probably somebody else. It's the enemy. And if you hear condemnation or comparison or cynicism, your red flag needs to go up in your spirit. Okay? 1 Corinthians 2:4-5. And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. When this word is spoken to you, it will be communicated with humility. Even boldness can be communicated with humility. So if somebody's got a word for you, it's not going to be out of condemnation. It can be bold in love, going, look, this is what the Holy Spirit's telling me. You can you know, discern whether or not this is for you. I mean, there is a humble way to deliver that message, because truth be told, we don't always 100% get that right. I mean, we just don't. Man's reasoning generally comes from a place of condemnation, comparison, self-promotion. So we've got to be listening very carefully and discern. There's a supernatural result when the Holy Spirit speaks. It penetrates deeper. So when somebody could tell you something, and in your discernment, it might be a red flag because it goes against the Word of God. But then if it's something that resonates, you just go, oh, man, yeah. Yeah, you're right about that. Even if it's something that's hard, maybe it's something that we're kind of getting called out on, we just go, yeah, you're right. Yeah, me and the Holy Spirit got to work that out. That makes sense? Okay. 1 Corinthians 2, 10 through 16. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things. Yes, the deep things of God. It's not just, you know, what Aunt Sally's wearing today, you know, getting a prophetic word. I believe she's wearing lace. I mean, no, it's not what we're talking about. It's the deeper things, right? It's the deeper things. It's things that penetrate the deep places. For what man knows the things of man except the spirit of man, which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the spirit of God. Now, we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God. That's pretty cool. And why did we get this? That we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. These things we also speak not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches. So sometimes sometimes it's not even going to be in words that we're going to understand in this here. It's going to be deeper than that. Okay? That's why somebody doesn't have to say a word, but they can be speaking without saying a word. Man, we've talked about this, right? You know, you can walk into a room and change the atmosphere and not say a word. Why? Because the Spirit of God is in you. Comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the verse 14, but the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. If you're just going to walk carnally, you're just not going to know this part. It's going to seem, you know, speaking in the spirit, speaking in tongues, speaking whatever is going to seem dumb to you. Sorry, there's a communication there that's different, and it's through the Spirit. All right, so we have the Holy Spirit speaks to his children and he affirms the Word of God. The Holy Spirit speaks and will confirm himself through the Word, people, and or circumstances. He will always confirm through godly counsel or circumstances what you heard him say initially. Because we're not, you know, 100% all spot on all the time. Even in hearing, sometimes we need to hear it again. The Holy Spirit knows that. And he will keep speaking until we get it. It's not just a one and done word. So you might get a Holy Spirit word of knowledge from somebody that has no idea who you are, and then it may be affirmed through somebody else. Or it could be another circumstance that you just go, oh, man. This door opened up that was not open before until after they spoke this word to you. So there are some things that we can recognize in that. All right. Holy Spirit has a voice, but he also But what keeps us from actually hearing the Holy Spirit? We're going to talk about this. And for this, I need 5 volunteers. I had my wife hunt down a couple. Oh, yes, come. Come. If my wife talked to you, yes, come. Got 5. All right. I need 1 of you standing in the middle. And then 4 of you surround that person. Okay? Are you going to be in the middle? Okay, Jess is in the middle. Can you, Kenzie, can you turn on this other mic? Yeah, just so that online folks can hear too. All right, so Jess, come stand right here. All right, Derek, right here. Becca, right here. Trev, right here. Right here. Okay. All right. Now, I'm going to have each of you. All right, you guys on the outside, you guys are called the distractions. I know this is real hard for Derek. I see this. Yeah. Okay. Yes. Okay. What the distractions are going to do is when I say go, they are going to begin reading pretty loudly what is on your sheet. And these things are random. All right. I'm just going to say they are completely random. While they are doing that, me and Jess are going to try to have a conversation, okay? So, on your mark, get set, go. So, Jess, how was your week? How are things going at school? Okay, all right, that's good. Yes, you guys are giving them up. Yes, thank you very much. All right, hang on. I need 2 of you to stay. I need Derek to stay, and I need you to stay. You guys can go down. All right. Here, you can hand me those, and I'll trade you out. Derek. Oh, Jess. Yeah, I need Jess. Sorry. Yeah. Okay, in the middle, and both of you on the both of my distractions, y'all face her. On either side, yes. All right, obviously, with there's so much going on, it was very difficult for Jess and I to have a conversation. And just as a note, I have to read a couple of these just so you know that what Jess was hearing. Yellow mustard was inspired by babies. Meat-eating orchids forgive no one yet. The man who was shot in Reno was also from Arkansas. Random noun alert, bug juice. All right, that was it. All right, so some of the most random things that you would ever hear. That was what they were being distracted with. All right, so obviously there's so many things that can cause us distraction, and certainly if you have kids and you try to have adult conversation with them underneath you around, distraction is part of your common life, right? Yeah. So you have to learn to navigate and how to listen with distraction. But I think we also have to understand, what voice are we trying to listen to? Because obviously, if you're listening to the guy say that, you know, some guy was shot in Reno, you're not hearing the person that you need to hear to actually have a conversation. And in light of that, obviously, I think you see where I'm going here, where, you know, there is always 2 voices. There's always 2 voices. Just like there were 2 trees in the garden. You know, there was one they couldn't eat. And there was many they could, right? There is a voice that tells you truth. There's a voice that does not. And so I want us to read this one, read both of them at the same time, and read. You're probably going to need to read a little louder on your side, okay? Okay. Go ahead.
You will die, but I will give you everlasting life in
Amen. Yes, thank you guys. Thank y'all. Thank y'all. Y'all may be seated. Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you. But isn't that how this kind of plays out? I mean, we're going through our day and you're hearing different voices. Those that are good and holy and true, and the ones that are lies, that are condemnation. So distraction is what keeps us from hearing the Holy Spirit. Listening to something other than the truth. And the Holy Spirit will not compete with any other louder voices that we allow or we choose to listen to. I want you to know that. I want us to understand that. He's not competing for your attention. It's no competition to him. He wants you to choose him. He wants you to choose his voice. He wants you to choose truth. Holy Spirit's voice is not condemnation, comparison, cynicism, or inadequacy, or that you're not enough. If you have those thoughts are not of God. You're listening to another voice. You're not listening to the Holy Spirit's voice. Comparison seems to be one of the enemy's slyest forms of deception, right? I mean, it can sound something like this in our thoughts. We may not even verbalize it, but in our thoughts, we might see somebody and go, well, why are they getting to do that? Who made them so spiritual? They're not as good as I am at that. Why are they getting to do that? Why does the right thing always seem to happen to them? We have to be listening very carefully to the voice of truth. One, because God is the one who elevates. God is the one who promotes. At your job, if you just keep getting passed on whatever it is, I can guarantee you what you think about that has everything to do with where you are. And that's not a condemnation. What it is that what voice are you listening to? Is it entitlement? Thinking, well, I need to be doing that. I should be doing this. If we trust God to provide for every need, he said he'd provide for every need, not just some of them, every need. If you are not promoted, it's that you don't need to be yet. You're not ready for that. Man, I can't tell you how many times in my little country music journey I went on that I felt like I was toiling and I could sing and I'd hear people and go, dude, man, how did that person get that doing that? You know, I felt that way and I would never verbalize it, but I felt that way at times. And God absolutely did not promote me in that because he had a different vision for me, different purpose. And the truth of the matter is, if I'd have been in that lifestyle, it'd have blown me up. As a person, spiritually, everything, Satan would have absolutely destroyed me and my family. So not everything that you think you need is the right thing for you. That's why it's so important to listen to the Holy Spirit's voice. His voice is always right. Always. So, what keeps us from hearing the Holy Spirit? Distraction. And the second one is disobedience. We cannot thumb our nose to God's commands and expect to hear him for blessing. You just can't. There's a way he says to do stuff. And then when we don't do it that way, we're off course and we're ever toiling away and things aren't going well. And then we go, but God, I thought you were good. He is. He's awesome. But there's kingdom principles that have to apply to our life before we will receive that blessing. Because if he just gives that blessing, then, you know, to somebody not following his principles, then he would not be the good and just God that he is to everyone. And that's tough to soak in. Because in our circumstances, we see here, but he sees here. And not everything that we see here is the next step for us. Sometimes we have to step around some things. We go, that's not for me. Many of us have gotten mad at God, thinking he's allowed something to happen in our life that is inconvenient. But if we rewind the tape, we will usually find that we ran through a spiritual stop sign or two, even if it was just not doing something God's way. And I know in this culture, this may be a little unpopular. In my household, we call it shacking. If you're living with somebody that you're not married to and asking for God's blessing upon your marriage, it's just not going to happen. Man, it just got quiet in this Methodist church, right? I mean, seriously, if we're going to do it God's way, then we're going to see the blessing. I didn't make it up. It's him. It's God. It's his way. If we are to continue to do things expecting God to... I mean, I know we like the phrase bless our mess, but I mean, there's a certain part of that that, yes, he gives grace for a repentant heart. He gets grace for those who have said, you know what? My way stinks. I'm ready for your way, God. That's where the grace comes in. It's not bless this mess. I'm going to go train wreck my life. Lord, save me right now. And then 2 weeks later, I'm back in the same deal, doing the same thing over and over again. That's a hard message, I know. But it is absolutely the truth. Holy Spirit does convict the ungodly of sin. That's the only time as an unbeliever you're going to hear the Holy Spirit's voice. You're going to find deep in those places of where you lack peace and you don't even know what peace is, because the peace of God is really the only peace that passes all understanding. But you're in that place trying to find peace in the midst of all these choices that derailed your life. It's right. It just doesn't work. Now, before we all just walk out of here depressed as all get out, there is hope, right? There is hope. When we listen to the Holy Spirit and we do come to that place of repentance and we say, yes, Lord, I'm done with my way. I'm laying down the old creature. I'm starting the new creature today that you form in me. Grace abounds. Grace abounds. And it's not just this grace that was taken care of at the cross. It's his empowerment grace to make it through things. If you think coming to Christ is supposed to be easy breezy after that, sorry, you signed up on the wrong side of the sheet. It's that daily dying to what your flesh really wants to do and doing exactly what God has asked you to do, and you find the fulfillment and the purpose and life. Over here, it's dead, it's toiling, it's hurt, it's hurtful. It's like holding on to things that we don't have any control of. I can't control not one thing somebody else does, but I can control whether or not I love them. And why am I supposed to love them? Well, because God asked me to. He set the example. How many people have thumbed their nose at God and Jesus on the cross when he died for them? And they say, you know, whatever. And yet Jesus still loves them. Man, we don't know that kind of love. I'm just saying, that's the goal. I was saying we're going to have to go deeper into our walk as believers here at New Day to reach this town, reach this county, to reach out further, because the days ahead, I don't know if you guys read the end of the book. I've read the end of the book. It doesn't end with everybody singing Kumbaya around a campfire. All right? Might be some fireballs, but it ain't going to be in a campfire, all right? So we've got to be ready and equipped to carry out what he's called our role to be. Our role to be is not to bring justice on every person that has wronged. He may lead us to be a part of a process of that, but we are not the justice. God is. What he has called us to do is, hey, love each other well, and they'll know you're mine. And hey, while you're doing that, love the people that don't love you. Love your enemies. And when you're done with that, hey, yeah, love them some more. Oh, that's hard stuff. Why? Because Jesus did. On the cross, after they spat on him, after they had crammed thorns in his head, beat him to nothing. Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. People that are bringing persecution on the church or making life difficult for you or cussing you out or whatever it is, they just don't know what they're doing. They just don't. They have no idea the train wreck that they're walking in. But yet God has given us eyes to see even past their train wreck. And go, they just need to know Jesus. And maybe they've confessed Jesus and they've just gotten off track. And they don't know. They've forgotten who they are. Guess what? God says, hey, you got to love them too. Restore a brother gently. Man, I'm challenged by that. That's why I'm pausing. I'm just like, John 16:8. And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin because they do not believe me. Of righteousness because I, Jesus, go to my Father and you see me no more. Because he was our righteousness. That's why. He died for our sin. And of judgment because the ruler of this world, Satan, is judged. It's not out of condemnation if you are in Christ Jesus. Romans 8:1 declares that. It's for pursuit of freedom. So when the Holy Spirit calls something out in us, and it might even be through somebody else that is humbly sharing this with you, we have to hear that and go, okay, is this true about me? And it's not out of condemnation that they're thinking, you are a horrible person. You need to get this right in your life. No, it's for freedom, for you to be free from who you are, apart from Christ. I mean, we pick up stuff all the time that is not a part of him. And we want to hang on to it like it's supposed to be a part of our journey. And then these loving people come along and say, you know, that's not for you. Or the Holy Spirit prompts in that deep place and goes, you know better. You know that's not for you. An example would be like a cellmate, you know, standing at an open doorway. If you've been ever done any kind of prison ministry or anything, I have not, but I have. It just seems like such a powerful time. Some people go to jail to get set free. When I say set free, free in Christ, the things that got them there, they become free of in jail. That's amazing. But if we look at ourselves as slaves to sin, as prisoners of sin, at times, and God's saying he sends people, he sends, you know, circumstances, he's trying to get our attention. the consequence of sin has spun us out, toiling away. And yet he's opened the jail cell door and we're standing there and he is on the other side going, hey, come, come on out. Come on, the door is open for you. The door is open. And yet we stand there and go, I don't know if you're real. I don't know if you've opened this door. The door is open. He's asking us to walk through. Lay down the prisoned stuff. We can shake it off because of a new creature. When we step out of that cell, we're new, brand new. We don't have to go back into the prison and go knocking on and say, hey, can you let me back in there? But sometimes we do that. We pick back up those things that we are not supposed to be picking back up. It's like walking back into the jail cell. What, the other question I ask, what if I'm not hearing him say anything, even though I'm asking? Has the Holy Spirit ever been in quiet season with you before? Yeah. Yeah. What I would say to that today is, at least for me, from my experience, I've had to go back to that place of that last thing he told me to do. Because generally, if he's quiet, he's waiting on us to do what he last said. And if he's quiet, it might just be that he's waiting for us to be obedient. He's asked us to do something. It was hard. Challenging, might even be a call on your life to do something greater that takes a lot of faith, but you kind of sidestep it and go, well, okay, all right, one day, Lord, yeah, I'll deal with that. And yet we're over here crying out for God to do something. Lord, show this to me. Give me this. And it feels like crickets, right? Spiritual crickets. There's not a phrase you didn't think you would hear today, I'm like. He's just quiet. Why? Because he's waiting for your obedience. He's there. He's walking with you. But as a parent of kids, I have seen the Lord in his dealings with me through some of my interactions with my kids. Anytime they're not doing something they're supposed to be doing, and I've already asked them, they will get a look from myself or Danielle at times. And they know the look, right? They're like, you going to keep doing it that way, or are you going to do it what I ask you to, you know? And sometimes that's the way God is. He will wait. And you can almost see him after you've gone through the journey and you've actually started to be obedient, you reflect on, oh, yeah, I can almost see God going, you done yet? You know, are you done yet? You done, you know, I mean, just any kind of, there's so many examples that come to my mind when I was, you know, images. It's that, are you done yet? Trying to do it on your own. Trying to make something happen. When the Holy Spirit said something a ways back and said, I want you to do this. And we finally go back to that place. We go, ah, there is your voice. Man, isn't that such sweet peace in your life? I long for that for you today. We tend to cry out in the heat of those moments, but how rooted are we in changing our mind to a heart of obedience? And the Holy Spirit's a gentleman. He's just not going to push his way through to be heard. All right. Hebrews 3:14 and 15. For we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end, while it is said, Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. If you've heard him and you just don't want to listen, there's the heart of rebellion. And I can tell you from experience, that is not a road you want to be on. It is not fun at all. Romans 8, it's 5 through 17, so hang in there with me. We will. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. Back to our love the Lord with all your mind, right? We have control of, Spirit gives us self-control. That's why he said you have self-control. So we can govern the thoughts of our mind. Why? He says, for to be carnally minded is death. If we're going to be all about the flesh, then we're just going to lead ourselves to death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity or opposition against God. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be in that line. For it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. Because they aren't even in the right line. You know, you're opposing God. You're not, this doesn't even apply to you. So then, those who are in the flesh cannot please God. If faith pleases him, then walking in the flesh is the antithesis of that. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin. But the Spirit is life because of righteousness, because of what Jesus did. This is where the Spirit changes and makes us new. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. The Spirit brings life in you. If you don't acknowledge him, then you don't even acknowledge. It's like having, it's like having the extension cord and a plug in and you just hadn't plugged it in. It's like just laying there and you're expecting it to work. Therefore, verse 12, therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the Spirit of adoption by whom we cry, Abba, Daddy, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if we are children of God, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. That's a great line to be in. Right? Heirs and joint heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. Man, there's so much there in that. Yeah, if you're ever wanting to know where to start, in your walk with Christ, want to know in the Bible where to start reading, John and Romans, all day, every day. Just get into it, all right? All right. The third thing that keeps us from hearing the Holy Spirit, and we'll land the plane here shortly, is distance. When we haven't spent time in his word or time in prayer, actually listening, not complaining. Prayer doesn't mean complaint. I know, I used to do it, Lord, why are you doing that? Lord, oh, please make this different, We are complaining in that. Can he handle that? Sure. Is it a prayer? No. It's just complaint. All right? So we can transition maybe from complaining to praying, Lord, give me strength. Let me know your grace is sufficient to make it through this trial. Help me hear your voice in the midst of. It's going to be hard to hear him if you're not spending time with him. Your level of experience with God is based upon your time with and submission to him. I'll say that one again. Your level of experience with God is based upon your time with and submission to him. He only comes when invited, and he's certainly going to test the genuineness of that pursuit. He will. I mean, in the heat of the moment, Lord, just get me out of this. I'll go to Africa. I'll do anything you have. You know, I mean, we may try to make deal with God, right, in the middle of, right? And that's not necessarily what we mean. He's going to test the genuineness of our pursuit. He's like, okay, I hear that complaint, but he may let us into a little longer season. I think the phrase that we read somewhere, I can't remember the address now, is like, after we have suffered a little while. Remember that phrase? Yes. Oh, that was a tough one, right? Sometimes we have to for that genuine faith to rise up. All right. So what is the Spirit's voice within us? What is that? You know, we've talked about everything around it. So what is it? It's that quiet, still, small, unassuming voice that's there inside, confirming what God is doing in you and what he's created you for. And most of the time, it will be this type of voice that we hear him through. Sometimes we would like to have it as a skillet over the head, right? I want you to do this. You know, that's not usually what he's doing, right? It's not usually his voice. Could be a loud voice like a trumpet. You know, Revelations 1:10 talks about that. I mean, I'm ready to hear something like that now, right? It also could be a voice through unlikely people. Or circumstances, or in case of 2 Peter, as well as Balaam's donkey. It could be an animal, right? I mean, if you start hearing from animals, I want that testimony here. Oh, I want to hear about this, all right? If your dog starts talking to you, I want to know about this, all right? Dog gave me a word today. All right, come on. Let's give him the microphone. Let's hear this. Yeah. Yes. But, I mean, God can, he's the God of impossible. He can do anything, all right? And sometimes we need somebody to speak like that. But we have the choice to listen, ultimately. Whether it's prompting to give somebody cash out of our pocket, to a word of knowledge, a prayer for healing, or to completely redirect our life pattern. He gives us the choice. So why don't you stand, Jared, you'll come in. Do you know his voice today? That's the question. Do you know his voice? So I'd like for us to bow our heads, close our eyes, and find that place with him. Maybe you haven't ever heard his voice. You don't necessarily know what the Holy Spirit's voice sounds like to you. We can pray for that today. One, you need to know Christ. You need to have said, I am done doing it my way. I want your way, Lord. I want to turn from this person I've been trying to be and receive the person you have created me to be. Once you've made that decision, then we ask the Holy Spirit baptize you, where he begins to speak to you and speak through you. He empowers you for ministry. He empowers you to reciprocate. He's not going to just leave you alone. He's going to equip you. So if he's calling you today in that way, we'd love for you to come forward. Meet us down front here. Our prayer team would love to pray for you today. To go, yes, I want that change. And maybe today you're here and you've been a believer for a while. But maybe you've gone through a season where you just haven't been obedient to his voice. Maybe you're that one that needs to go back to that place of hearing his voice. The last place that was. What was he asking you to do? And to come forward today and ask him, I want to make this right today, Lord. I want to be obedient today. If that's you, we can pray for you today as well. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for your word. Lord, and your word is definitely life and life-giving. Lord, but I also thank you for your Holy Spirit that leads us and guides us into your word. That you speak to us. That you didn't leave us here to try to figure it out on our own or just kind of guess, but that you sent the Holy Spirit so that we would know what you're asking of us, so that we would know your character, so that we would know your love, so that we could communicate your love and mercy to those around us and be the hands and feet of Jesus. Help us, Lord. Lord, we love you. We praise you.
thank you for your faithful love. That you desire relationship with us. That you long to be called Abba from us. Daddy God. You desire that intimate relationship. So Lord, today we just surrender. We ask that you would quiet the voices of untruth and highlight the voice of the Holy Spirit, Lord. May it just be salve to our soul. May it just minister such peace to our heart today to know that you are right there walking with us through the storm. That you are walking with us in that big life decision. That you are walking with us even in the unknown of where that next bill payment is going to come from. Lord, you are so good. We love you. We thank you for your faithfulness. And thank you for the Holy Spirit who does not leave us alone. Pray these things in your powerful and wonderful name. Amen and amen. Yes. Go ahead, Quinn.
There's somebody here who feels that they're too far gone. You feel that you're too lost in your sin. Confessed before, you've cried out for deliverance, and you're bound up, and your sin is holding you captive. And Jesus says, I have come to set you free. There is nothing impossible for me. And he is calling you now. Be bold, come forward. And kneel at the altar and trust your Savior. He is a mighty God. He is mighty to deliver. And he will break the chains that are holding you in bondage. Don't suffer one more day under the oppression of the devil.
That's right.
Jesus destroyed the works of the enemy. And we will pray for you and declare life over you. Come now. Choose this day to let your Savior shine his face upon you and bring deliverance to you. Don't wait. Your life is in the balance right now. This is life and death for you. Come. Come. Come to the Father. Come to the Father.
Thank you. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for working this morning, Lord, for your presence, Lord, that your peace is real and it's good and it's offered freely. And so, Lord, we just come before you thanking you for the many blessings. Even through the midst of trial, Lord, your presence is powerful. You energize us in those times. So, Lord, we ask that even through the midst of trial, Lord, that we continue listening, we continue loving,
yes.
We continue obeying.
Yeah.
And we just say thank you for your mercy and grace in our lives, that we can translate that to others. Because you are so good. You are so good. In spite of the behavior of mankind, you are good. And so, Lord, thank you for being that example for us, calling us to that love, that heart. That's your heart to love. Help us love, Lord. Not just you, but everyone else. Lord, thank you. Thank you. We pray these things in your powerful, wonderful, magnificent name.
Thank you, Paul. All right, church. It's quite the challenge to learn to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit versus your own. So, it's good stuff to take home with us this week. While we're challenged spiritually, we do have... next week, next Sunday, we have an opportunity to come together with other believers that evening in what is called Community Praise, and Valley View Baptist Church will be hosting the event for all of us to come together and just be able to share music and bonding, connecting time. So, next Sunday night at 6:30. Is it 6 o'clock or 6:30?
Six o'clock. Yeah.
My bad. 6 o'clock. That's right. 6 o'clock next Sunday night. So let's go over there and enjoy an eclectic collection of people coming together with praise and worship. And it is fun. It's healthy and it's good. It's good. So put that on your calendar, and let's do that next Sunday night together. Today, thank you very much, Miss Martha and Miss Virginia. And do I see, is it Miss Linda back there as well? They've got the buffet ready for lunch today. So please stay and eat with us. Today is meatball and sides. And then next week, we have soups and salads. So if you want to contribute to that, soups and salads next week, okay? Believe it or not, supposedly I hear on the calendar and read on the calendar that it is officially fall, even though I'd like the temperatures to go ahead and agree with that. Yeah, amen. Hopefully maybe soups will be great with a little cooler weather next Sunday. We'll just pray for that. Okay.
It's prophetic.
Yeah, I hope. So, and then go ahead and pencil it in on your calendar for October 20th for our vision dinner to come together. We will have details as we get closer, but please plan to be a part of that event that evening to come together and be able to get where New Day Body is headed, what our mission is, and how we are going to strategize and work together to be able to make an impact in our county, in our city. It's not one person's job or one small group's job to impact. It is Christ in you individually.
That's right. Everybody's
to come
part.
Together and let's do this and make an impact. So, October 20th, that is the vision dinner. That's all I have.
All right.
Okay. Thank you. Right. Oh, wait.
Yes.
Can we do this?
Sure.
Again, Morgan and Tanner, would you mind? Would you come up here for me? Morgan, as some of you know, and some of you don't because it's been a few years, she graduated from Berryville High School. She was a part of our youth group. She went off to college, and then she met this handsome, what I hear is your knight in shining armor. Is that what I've read? Over and over and
yes,
over again.
Right.
Pretty much. It's a high pedestal.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Enjoy it up there. But Morgan got married. Tanner and they, how long? Has it been 2 years? 2 years?
Yeah.
God, 2 years?
I know, right? Yeah.
Okay, 2 years. So she's all grown up. Now they're starting their own family. And Rafe, what's the name? Middle? Rafe Lee. Rafe Lee is due November 27th.
Yes.
Just after Thanksgiving, yeah? This year.
Yeah, right,
yeah,
in
somewhere
middle.
Right in there. So, Morgan and Tanner are very active in their church now. And Morgan's got, I don't know Tanner, I don't know your story, but I do know Morgan's story because I walked with her a little bit through it. But then, man, God became really real to you after you went off and lived independently. It all started connecting. And now she is on the praise team at her church and is serving and is pouring into and mentoring. She's mentoring the youth in her church now.
Woo! Yes, yes. Yeah, go and send, right? Send out. That's awesome.
So I just want to join with y'all, church body. Blessings over Tanner and Morgan. Now they get a chance to parent and learn what parenting is all about. And I'm praying for your journey because it is one of the most challenging that God calls you to, that you have an opportunity to walk. It's the most trying, but it will personally grow you, and it will personally test you, and it will personally bless your socks off. So, those that, yeah, come on, parents and grandparents and sister and brother-in-law, come on, brother. Let's join with her family and just pray over them as we are about to be excused for lunch. And I'm going to pray blessing over Morgan and Tanner. And if y'all will, pray in agreement. And then we will dismiss to our lunch and time to eat and fellowship together. So, Father, thank you so very much. First, for the reality of you. Thank you for what you've done in Morgan's heart, in her spirit, for becoming so real. That, Father, she can't deny you, and now she wants to share the wisdom of the knowledge of you and pour it into those just a little younger than her. Father, thank you for Tanner and for the blessing that he is to her. God, I pray blessing over their marriage. I pray that you, Father, continue to be the guide, the light, the major presence in their home. The enemy can't have them because they've already declared that they belong to you. And so, Father, as they are walking in relationship with each other, God, I pray blessing over their parenting journey just around the corner. God, I pray safety and health over Morgan as she's carrying Rafe. Father, I pray for health over Rafe. And Father, I pray give them strength when weakness is giving way, sleepless nights. Father, when they just don't see how in the world they deserved it, God, enlighten them that this is what you are to us. Thank you so much, Father, for the reality of you. Thank you for their parents. Thank you for how they've raised them, Father, and never left them and supported them, Father. Thank you, Lord. You've glued this group together. And for that, the gratefulness overflows. I can feel it, and we know it. Father, those of us on the outside looking in on this family, thank you for the honor of walking with them, for the honor of knowing them, for the honor of walking through the struggles and the hard times together. God, thank you for the victories. Thank you for the happiness. Thank you for the loosened, chained moments and the blessings that are here and the blessings that are to come. God, we praise you. Father, bless our fellowship time together as we are dismissing to eat together and come together just after this service. Thank you for meeting with us in our weakness. Thank you for making us strong when flesh-wise we just didn't think we could do anymore. God, help us to hear you. Help us in the midst of our struggles to hear and see you. God, help us put one foot in front of the other. Be our guide. Reveal to us what we need to know. And give us vision. Lord, we love you. New Day family, we say in agreement, amen.
Morgan and Tanner, so I sense the Lord saying to you guys that the Lord's developing you and growing you into oaks of righteousness. Have you ever heard that phrase? You're kind of saplings right now. You're young and you're growing, but the Lord's growing you into oaks of righteousness. And that he's going to use you. You're going to be a source of stability for a lot of people. They're going to look to you and as a source of strength, and they're going to draw strength from you and from your marriage and your family. So, Lord, we release that word over them today, that, and we declare and decree that they are oaks of righteousness, that you are growing them up into this example of righteousness and strength in you. But it's in you. And so, God, we release that blessing and we release that reality into them and into their family. And we thank you for them, God. We thank you for the way that you're going to use them for your glory, that you have glorious plans and purposes for this family, and that everything that every way that you're directing them, it's all about you is what I'm saying. It's you that's leading and guiding them, and they are sensitive to your voice, and they're going to be used mightily. I just see that very clearly. The Lord's using you guys mightily because of your steadfast faith and your commitment to him, and he's going to use your family in this way. We thank you for that, God.
Amen. You are dismissed.
Amen. Woo. It's good stuff.